Sanctions back on. Hours from now, the Trump administration will take the first major step of reimposing sanctions on Iran. These are the sanctions relaxed by the Obama administration as part of the Iran nuclear deal. They go back into effect at 12:01 tonight, hitting gold, coal, steel, aluminum, Iran's auto sector. This morning, Trump officials say that they don't want regime change. They're just looking for a change in behavior. At the very same time as they're throwing this punch, though, the White House is also reiterating it's willing to talk and sit down with Iran without preconditions. Joining me right now, CNN Global Affairs analyst Max Boot. He's a foreign policy advisor to the McCain, Romney, and Rubio presidential campaigns. It's great to see you, Max.
Thanks, Kate.
So at this moment, what will sanctions being slapped back on Iran, what do they do now?
Well, there's no question it'll increase the economic pain on Iran. You've had the Iranian currency already fall in roughly by half this year, and there is unrest in Iran, and I'm sure this will contribute to that. The most important part of it, of course, is going to happen in 90 days when they're going to slap oil sanctions on Iran. But, you know, it's not clear to me that the Trump administration has any plan. And let me make that actually stronger. I don't think the Trump administration has any plan for how to translate these sanctions into an actual agreement that would end the Iranian nuclear program to a greater extent than it was already ended with the agreement that Trump tore up a few months ago, under which Iran had given up 97% of its fissile material. At the moment, I think the Trump strategy is basically unilateral sanctions, tough tweets, and a lot of hope, and I don't think that's going to be successful.
Well, you actually raised something interesting there. The ball is in whose court then? Sanctions go back on. Iran needs to come to the Trump administration to say, let's talk, or Trump needs to go to Iran and is already saying, I guess, we'd be open to talking. It's unclear, though, to me.
Trump seems to be pursuing the same kind of strategy he pursued with North Korea of issuing blood-curdling tweets, which he did a couple weeks ago, and then a week later saying, oh, you know, I'm ready to talk without preconditions. And he thinks that strategy was successful with North Korea. News earth to Trump, it has not succeeded. North Korea is not giving up their nuclear weapons, and there's no sign it's going to succeed with Iran because the sanctions that we're going to impose, I don't think are going to put sufficient pressure on Iran to make bigger concessions than they already made with the Obama administration, because every indication is that the Russians and Chinese are coming in to take over the kind of work that European and U.S. companies were doing in Iran. China will probably continue buying Iranian oil. So I don't think this policy is going to work. In fact, there's very few, they seem to have hope of regime change, but there's very few examples in history of sanctions actually forcing regime change. South Africa might be the only one. Countries like North Korea, Venezuela, and Cuba have endured decades of U.S. sanctions without changing regimes or changing their behavior. So, you know, I don't see a well-thought-out Trump administration policy in place here.
I just wonder what the status of the relationship really is, because over the weekend, the president raised again the idea of meeting with the Iranian president, much like, as you're talking about, kind of the meeting he had with Kim Jong-un. But how would you describe the status of this relationship, non-relationship with Iran right now?
It's obviously a very tense relationship. I mean, if I were the Iranians, I would actually take Trump up on his offer to meet, because given Trump's track record, he is easily duped in these kinds of negotiations. He is prone to go into a negotiation like with North Korea or the European Union, breathing fire and brimstone, and then it's all sweetness and light, and he's backslapping everybody, praising his interlocutors. I mean, he could easily be praising, President Rouhani as being very smart, brilliant, intelligent, warm, witty, etc., after a meeting, and, you know, concluding a deal, which is probably going to be half as onerous as the one that he tore up. I think there's actually a lot in it for Iran to meet. I think they're short-sighted not to take advantage of Trump in that respect. But, you know, assuming they're not going to meet, I think you're going to see, you know, further tensions ratcheting up.
Well, let me ask you then about North Korea, because CNN is reporting that North Korea actually believes that there's a strong possibility of a second summit between President Trump and Kim Jong-un later this year. But just if you look at the latest facts since their last summit, you've got the Secretary of State saying that North Korea is continuing to make fissile material, images indicating that North Korea is making new missiles. But North Korea did return what the Trump administration believes are the remains of more than 50 service members from the Korean War, which was part of that agreement, part of what they discussed in their summit. What's the point of a second meeting now?
That's a great question, Kate. I mean, everything I'm seeing suggests that North Korea is taking Donald Trump to the cleaners. I mean, his credulity in the face of North Korean defiance is just staggering, because North Korea is not taking any significant steps to denuclearize as they supposedly promised at the Singapore summit. They're just doing the absolute minimum, turning over these 55 remains, which may or may not be U.S. service members' remains. They could be dog bones for all we know. And they are continuing their development of ICBMs. They're continuing their development of nuclear fuel, as Mike Pompeo acknowledged. So there is no sign that they're actually denuclearizing, and the notion of rewarding them with a second summit, I mean, that is ludicrous. I mean, the first one was bad enough, but a second one, after they haven't done anything significant, is absurd, because clearly what the North Koreans are angling for is major, massive concessions on the part of the U.S., for example, a peace treaty with North Korea, which could pave the way for the pullout of U.S. forces from South Korea after Trump already agreed to suspend U.S. military exercises with South Korea. They are looking for major concessions on the U.S. part, and they're not doing anything on significant on their part. But, you know, Trump is kind of going along with this travesty because he wants to run around and beat his chest and claim that he's the world's best deal maker and he got a great deal from North Korea.
Let's see, Max. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Kate.